Hello everyone and welcome to Build Fix, my monthly series where I do my best to help people build new computers and get the parts picked for those computers with the help of PC Part Picker, who sponsors this series. So a big thank you to them. I often look forward to shooting this video, but this month, and actually last month a little bit too, thanks to the DRAM shortage that is going on right now, I've been a little bit more hesitant to tell people, hey, here's how to build a new computer right now, because prices for a typical RAM kit that you would use to build a new computer right now have about tripled since October. So with that in mind, the general advice right now is that if you have a functional computer, to treat it very well, be very kind to it, and say nice, positive things so that it will last as long as possible. But if you're in the situation where you need a PC right now, hopefully this video will help you out.
Excellent!
Today's video is brought to you by the Paul's Hardware Store on paulshardware.net, the only official source for Paul's Hardware merchandise. Tantalizing t-shirts, brilliant beer sets, high-quality hoodies, and more, all featuring the classic thumbscrew for tasteful and refined viewers, or the 8-bit thumbscrew for tasteful and refined viewers who hate curves. New designs are added sporadically and at random, so head over to paulshardware.net and get some of that sweet, sweet merch right now. Or not right now, after you watch the video. Either way. So as usual, Build Fix starts off with a poll where I request people to send in their parts lists, even during a RAM shortage. And there's also this poll where people can vote on, like, what's your favorite thing about Christmas? That's kind of what I was going for. I don't know if that came across. I'm gonna choose family. Family came in last, apparently. Everyone's more excited about presents, food, and perhaps a little bit of snow play. Fair enough, some people's family experiences are different than others, but the builds I'm doing today, and I've just got two of those, and also some questions were picked from the comments section down below. So thank you to everyone who went in and replied to that. And getting right into it, I'm just gonna answer a few general questions about PC building that I feel like might help people during these troubled times. DonnyDonDon55 asks, I need to upgrade my RAM due to work. I have a 2x16 gig kit right now. Can I just buy another 2x16 gig kit, or do I really have to bite the bullet and buy a 2x32 gig or 4x16 gig set? Thanks, Paul. I look forward to your CES content. Thank you very much, Donnie. We're looking forward to it too. Got the rooms booked, planning underway. The simple answer to your question is that yes, you can combine two disparate memory kits together. If you have a 2x16 gig kit right now and you're using two of your DIMM slots and you have two more open, if you have a motherboard with four DIMM slots, you can buy another 2x16 gig kit and add it to those other slots. The thing that you'll be trading off if you do that is probably going to be your memory speed, and you might need to dive into the world of manual memory overclocking or manually setting the memory speed or memory timings, which can be a little bit challenging because it involves trial and error, and especially if you're trying to figure out what the fastest speed you can get to be stable with two different memory kits, it might take a bit of time. So to further explain, any memory kit that you get is gonna have a rated speed, it's probably gonna have timings, and it's usually gonna have either an XMP profile or an Expo profile. XMP is typically for Intel setups, Expo is for newer AMD setups. And what those profiles allow you to do is to go into your UEFI or your BIOS, quickly plug in that profile and not have to worry about too much else. Most memory kits that are reasonable speeds, which for an AM5 platform right now is DDR5, 6000 or maybe 6200 or so, are gonna work with the Expo profile or the XMP profile without too much more difficulty. The thing to keep in mind though is if you bought a two-stick setup like 2x16 gigs, which is very common, the Expo or XMP profile is for a two-stick setup. Getting even the exact same kit and plugging in that profile won't always be stable because a four-stick setup might need different speeds and timings than a two-stick setup. That is why the easiest way to add more memory is actually to ditch the two-stick setup and then upgrade to a four-stick setup, or this is actually an eight-stick setup, an 8x16 gig DDR4 kit that I used in my Threadripper build. The kits that are sold together are going to have an XMP or an Expo profile for that 4 DIMM configuration or 8 DIMM configuration in this case. But if you already have, say, a 32 gig DDR5 setup installed and you want to add 32 more gigs, and because of the RAM shortage, you maybe need to go with a different brand or something that has different timings out of the box, you can plug all four of those in. I would recommend going and disabling the XMP or Expo profile with your existing kit if you do that. And your PC should boot up just fine, but it's going to boot up at the base standard, the base JEDEC standard for DDR5 memory, which I believe on AM5 is like DDR5 5200 or maybe even 4800. So your system will be running and you'll have the memory capacity that's installed, but the speeds are gonna be a little bit slower. So you might see a drop off in like the frame rates that you're used to getting with the original two-stick kit, for example. From there, you need to go into your BIOS and start bumping up the speeds. So you might wanna try like DDR5 5600 before you go up to 6000. Then you'd also probably go in and start tightening up the timings. And again, that's just gonna be a trial and error. It will take time to find the sort of sweet spot in terms of how both of the memory kits are gonna play nicely together. That's about all the advice I can give in the context of this video, but the short answer to your question is yes, asterisk, with all the other stuff I just said. Next question from Krish7267. I just need a 4 terabyte SATA SSD for now, and I'll be set for a while. So this is representing someone who maybe already has an existing system, is just looking for an upgrade, and ideally that upgrade is not memory. Unfortunately, SSD and storage prices have been creeping up as well because supposedly AI is eating those things too. But I'm curious as well, just looking at SSDs with the form factor, typically M.2 2280 is what would fit in a typical motherboard, but M.2 2242 is worth taking a look at as well. So if we sort by price per gigabyte, and note that I haven't limited the capacity here, we can see that in terms of price per gigabyte, 4 terabyte drives are actually the sort of best bang for your buck right now, and the cheapest one is a Silicon Power UD90 for $275. So that's the short answer to your question. Grab that one. We also have some Clev and King spec options here, so you can still get a 4 terabyte NVMe SSD for less than $300, and that is, I don't want to say good news, but I suppose could be worse news. And look, there it is, ready and available, add to cart, actually being sold directly by Silicon Power. I've noticed that recently, like Clev and some of these are now just doing their marketplace stores on sites like Newegg and selling directly. And I imagine that is more profitable for them. I also wanted to take a quick look at 2 terabyte options. And it looks like our cheapest 2 terabyte drives are around $150, which is also pretty disappointing because 2 terabyte drives should be around 100 or less than 100. So you can see that the prices of those are creeping up as well. Cheapest 1 terabyte coming in at 79 or so. Although do note that that is a SATA drive. It is possible to have an M.2 drive that connects and still uses the SATA protocol. So double check and make sure if you're trying to get an NVMe SSD, they should be at least 3 times faster than SATA drives, and don't accidentally get a SATA. Get an actual PCIe Gen 3 or Gen 4 by 4 is what those should need. Moving on to question number 3 from GGZKX, X79. Don't be scared. I was not scared, and my initial thought was, I'm gonna do that. I'm gonna do an X79 build. If you're not familiar, X79 is an Intel high-end desktop platform from back when the Intel high-end desktop options were like the best of the best. So just in order to like put some feelers out here, I'm choosing the X79 chipset, and can you even do that? Can you buy? Oh, right, so supposedly there's a couple ASRock X79 boards that sell for around $300, but they're out of stock. But yes, if you weren't considering the used market and you wanted to do an X79 build right now, the only board that PCPartPicker has in stock is the ASUS P9 X79 LE LGA 2011. You guys remember when ASUS was doing this color scheme? I kind of miss this color scheme, the light blue. And even there, you gotta go in and buy from a seller, like this seller who has 2 stars with 137 ratings. I wouldn't trust them. I wouldn't trust them. Even the supposedly better option only has a 70% feedback review, so. So while I will say that I'm not scared of an X79 build, the thing that is the most scary is actually obtaining the motherboard. And that's a weird thing about sort of the life cycle of PC hardware over time, is that motherboards are often the most common thing that you can find when you're looking at current generation stuff. But as you look at older and older platforms, I feel like the motherboards are what become more and more scarce. And I, over the past 5 years, have received multiple requests from people who are like, Paul, do you have an X79 motherboard that I could use or borrow or something like that? And my answer is, I'm sorry, I only have one. I saved one that is functional in case I need it. I hope it is still functional. I haven't powered it up in a while. But that's pretty much as far as I can reasonably go with that one. All right, I do actually have 2 builds for today. This is just sort of, these are just testers. I'm just sort of taking a look, feeling the water, seeing how things are. I wanted to look at a 9800X3D build, kind of the sort of the higher end example of building a gaming PC, which a couple months ago didn't have too many pitfalls to fall in. But this comes from Cindy Elaine TS. Hey Paul, what I've been piecemealing together, we have a 9800X3D, Corsair Nautilus 360mm AIO, MSI X870E Carbon, MSI RTX 5080 Expert, a 2 terabyte, 4 terabyte SSD configuration with an 8 terabyte Seagate hard drive, 1200 watt power supply, Thermaltake View 380XLTG ARGB case. This is an upgrade or a replacement for a Minis Forum build. Currently got a 1440p 144Hz monitor and a 1600p 240Hz monitor. Here's where I'll pause and say, if you're looking at monitors and you're having more than one monitor, focus on one monitor as your gaming monitor and look for something that's high refresh rate. And then for your other monitor, look for something that has better pixels, not necessarily faster pixels. A 4K 60 Hertz panel that has really good color depth, I would prefer as a secondary monitor that I'm not gaming on to another monitor that has really high refresh rate that I'm never really gonna be taking advantage of because I'm gonna use the better gaming monitor that I have. Sole exception being like a wraparound setup where you're trying to do three monitors. Anyway though, the thing I noticed that's missing from this list is memory, and that's a convenient thing to leave out right now, but even with the memory not there, this entire build, and a lot of this has to do with the like $600 or $700 worth of storage that's in there, is coming in at over $4,000, again, without memory. But since a lot of these parts, it seems like, have already been purchased, I'm not going to critique your build, I'm going to adjust it to make it something that's more broadly recommendable to someone who's looking to build a system along these lines right now. So, editing the parts list. The 9800X3D is still the best CPU for gaming, only $5 up from the Black Friday lows of about $450, not too bad. You have a 360mm AIO, it's often a pitfall to spend too much on an AIO, so keeping it to $100-ish is reasonable to me. Corsair is a solid brand for that. So at 110, the Nautilus 360 doesn't cause me too much hesitation. Same goes for this motherboard. You can often overspend on motherboards that are $500 plus, but if you're looking for the higher end X870E option, that does give you more I/O, so there's a functional upgrade there. As long as you're not going too much beyond $350-ish, I think we're still okay there. There are probably other options more towards 250 that could slot in here, but just trying to keep things simple, I'm gonna leave that be. You have a nice range of storage. Current prices are a little bit high for some of these, so again, just for the sake of recommendation, I'm gonna remove those storage drives just so I can drop in something that's a little bit more price effective for right now. Likewise, an RTX 5080 should cost $1,000. I feel like close to $1,900 is too much of a markup. So we'll see if we can find a cheaper one there. For a higher end build, a case in the $150-ish price range is good. The Thermaltake View 380XL is a good case, so we'll leave that. Interestingly, the Corsair HX1200i is not listed on PC Part Picker. The 1000i is listed, and since the wattage on this build, well, it's less now because I removed the graphics card. The wattage on this build is around 600 watts, so you don't need 1200 watts. You can easily get away with the 1000. But even there, I'm gonna try to find us something a little bit cheaper. Lastly, we've added these Corsair RS120 fans, which are all black fans, and I got the impression that that's what you're going for with this build, largely due to the AIO choice. I am gonna drop that down to one kit because I feel like with the fans included in the case and an additional kit here, you should also still be fine. Although again, I'm not knocking your aesthetic choices there if you wanna swap the fans out. But all right, look, we brought the price down to $1,100, but we need to add some more parts here. So right off the bat, gonna bite the bullet and see how much our memory is gonna run us for a DDR5 6000 speed kit, the middle of the road. For AM5, you probably want 6000, maybe 6200 or 6400, 32 gigs, and you might want like a 64 gig setup. 32 gigs and 64 gigs might be the way to go for this build since it's higher end, but 32 gigs is way less money right now. And we're looking for reasonable cast latency as well. You want good timings below 34. And yeah, fortunately, I don't want to say fortunately, but these prices have not gone up too much in the past week and a half since I did RAM Price Watch. The cheapest option that fits these criteria is about $314. We've got the Silicon Power Value Gaming set that's $330. But look, that's an all black kit that's gonna match with your color scheme. It doesn't have any gaudy RGB. Good timings even at CL30. I always like to go into the memory. If you're not good at memory timings and speed adjustments and overclocking, make sure there's an AMD Expo profile if you're building on AM5. And that does fit. Secondary option here, I would say the G-Scale Flare X sets are also quite nice for about $5 more. But hey, we'll keep the price down with the Silicon Power option. I already did this search and found the Silicon Power drive, so I'm just gonna go with that as well because it's the best bang for your buck in terms of storage. For our RTX 5080, we can get an $1,100 option. And look, it's still all black. Note that on PC Part Picker, you can choose add from filter. So that's just gonna put in the cheapest RTX 5080 that's currently for sale, which is this $1,100 one. And finally, for the power supply, we only need 850 watts or better for the RTX 5080s. So there are choices here for less than $1,000 in the $80 range. I highly recommend checking the PSU tier list to make sure you get a power supply that's not horrible, because some are horrible. Epevia has sort of a reputation for that. But there are some good choices down here. The Thermaltake Tough Power GFA3, the Montec Century 2. I like the Montec Century 2, let's go with that one. But okay, here is my updated build, and we're coming in at $2,900-ish or so. That brings it a lot down from the 4K that we started with, and I have added memory, although I have taken away some storage, so there are some trade-offs here, but that brings the price down. And this represents, I'd say, probably roughly the best price. You could maybe shave off another $100 or so by going with some cheaper choices here or there. But if you're looking for a 9800X3D, RTX 5080 build, this is kind of what you're looking at right now in December 2025. It is not the best price. It's probably $250 to $300 more than it would have been if you purchased all these parts back at the beginning of October. Still, it is at least possible, but hopefully going through my choices there has helped you out a little bit. Lastly, Sneezy Rider 1 is starting off with an AM4 build, and a lot of people are looking at AM4 as sort of a fallback option because DDR4 prices have also gone up, unfortunately, just like DDR5. However, they can be cheaper. You can sometimes find cheaper DDR4 than DDR5. So we're only starting off with four parts here, 5600X, B550M motherboard, 9060XT 16GB, which is a really solid choice for a entry-level, slightly mid-range GPU, and the Lian Li A3 case, which is a good case that I've also built in. All right, so starting us off, 5600X for $200 is a lot to me. And if you're looking here, it's actually been on sale for closer to $165. If you already have this part, no worries, but I would consider the 5600 for $50 less. It's not gonna be too much of a drop off in terms of performance. Still comes with a Wraith Stealth cooler, and it's gonna drop your price down by quite a bit. I chose the ASRock B550M-HDV because it's $70 and it actually has reasonable power delivery built in as well. And then for our memory, we want at least a slightly higher speed than the base level DDR4, so 2933 or better. And going with a 16GB RAM kit is also gonna be a way to possibly keep the price down. Although it feels pretty bad paying $90 plus for a 16GB kit. You gotta have memory, and cast latency 16 is also not terrible in terms of DDR4 timing. Now the motherboard is pretty limited on connectivity, but it does have one M.2 slot, so we wanna take advantage of that. Again, not going for the SATA option here. The step up from there is this, there's a GameStop version SSD, what? I don't know. Honestly, among these, I would go for the 980 Pro for $90 if that was for sale. But it does seem to be sold out. How about Seagate? Sure, I'll pay $5 more for a Seagate versus a TimeTech, whatever TimeTech is. I would go for the Seagate or the Kingston NV2, honestly, among this shortlist here, or the Crucial P3 Plus. But there we go, we have a $95 16GB memory kit. We already have a graphics card picked out. Again, I use the parametric filter there just to look for the cheapest 16GB 9060 XT, which is currently $370. We got the Lian Li A3 Micro ATX case. Again, a really good case for like $70 or $80. And our estimated wattage is currently at 309 watts. Now the minimum you're gonna want for a 9060 XT is gonna be 550 watts. Safer bet is 600 or 650 watts. And the other nice thing about going with a Radeon RX 9060 XT is you don't have to worry about getting the 12V 2x6 connector or something like that built in. So here you've got thermal take options that are relatively inexpensive. The Tough Power GX2 is a reasonable choice because it is a little bit better in terms of efficiency. It's 80 plus gold rated. So yeah, that's the one I'm gonna pick, $55. And that gets us a somewhat reasonable, given the context, given the circumstances with the memory shortage and everything, AM4 builds for about $900. Of course, it'd be great to have a 32GB memory kit instead of 16, but this will get you up and running with a functional gaming PC that can also do lots of other stuff, and keeping AM4 alive for just a little bit longer. But that is gonna wrap it up for Build Fix for December 2025. Thank you guys so much for watching this video. Links to the builds and some of the parts I picked out are down in the video's description. Thank you to all of you who responded to the community post, and a closing reminder to check out my store at PaulsHardware.net, where we do have the end of the year sale still going on. Thank you very much for all your support. Thanks for watching, you guys. Hit the thumbs up button if you enjoyed this video, and we'll see you all in the next one.